How y'all doing?
What's up?
Yeah. I gotta calm down first. I'm just really excited to be here. Like, I mean, not even as a scholar, just as a fan of Houston hip hop. This is like the, it's not the culmination of my career, but it's really the high point, you know, at this stage. So I wanna thank Julie Grove, University of Houston Libraries, for inviting me to be a part of this conference. That being said, I'm here to talk about slab culture. Now, hip hop culture has historically been defined in part by the dynamic relationship between the individual and the physical environment. Hip-hop's earliest participants suffered economic restriction, spatial racism, and social isolation that rendered them virtually voiceless in the American landscape. In response, these African-American and Puerto Rican youth found creative ways to make their voices heard and their humanity recognized. Graffiti writers began marking up public spaces with tags comprised of individual aliases and street names. Eventually, as more participants entered the culture, the tags got more elaborate and the canvases much larger. Subway cars soon became the most valued graffiti canvas. Why? Well, one, because they're big, white, and therefore perfect for painting. But more importantly, they traveled throughout the city, broadcasting the artist's individual identity wherever they rested. The painted subway car allowed these desperate writers to have their voices heard. It was a medium through which these socially and politically muted communities could join the public conversation. So through these moving canvases, dynamic colors, and creative phrases, graffiti artists seized control of the physical and social environments. Now, in Houston's indigenous, localized hip-hop culture, young minority men also use large motorized vehicles to express themselves. Slabs, as they're often called, are typically oversized American sedans that have been tricked out with explosive paint jobs and various types of vehicle adornment. Now, slab culture differs greatly from graffiti. Rather than stealing spray paint and then sneaking into train yards, slab owners invest thousands of dollars in the creation of their slabs. They typically purchase their car when they're in modest states and slowly convert them into something more elaborate. During this process, the vehicle becomes inscribed with individual experience and identity and broadcasts this to the outside world. Now, at the same time, slabs reflect a strong sense of community. In the 1990s, when tensions between Houston's north side and south side were high, slabs were chief markers of community allegiance. Slab owners on the south side commonly painted their slabs red, while participants in the north painted them blue. And even as tensions have died down, these two colors continue to signify cultural location. In addition to paint, trunk displays often feature references to neighborhoods, streets, schools, and social groups. And furthermore, slabs are not meant to be driven every day. They typically appear at important community-based events, such as parties, concerts, and informal car shows. Slabs were even on display at the recent Trayvon Martin community rally at Emancipation Park. In short, slabs are sites of serious individual and community identity formation and promotion. Now, just as the treble-heavy, high-fidelity sounds of New York hip-hop was made to be consumed through headphones by listeners riding graffiti-ridden subway cars, the down-tempo, lo-fi, bass-heavy screw music was the perfect match for riding slab. The slow music acts as a pace setter, enabling slab riders to showcase their cars. And at the same time, the deep, muddy bass produced by screw tapes allows slab riders to literally knock pictures off the wall, making their presence felt for blocks and blocks. And since screw tapes function as an intra-community communication system, or underground radio, indexing the lifestyle of those in the South Side, North Side, and other areas, it's not surprising that slab culture was popular subject matter on the screw tapes. Tapes such as my favorite, Wineberry Over Gold, and Only Rollin' Red, derived their name from slab aesthetics. Now, one tape that truly exemplifies the multi-layered relationship between slabs, identity, and community was Southside Holden, which, if I'm correct, was a dedication to deceased SUC affiliate Pat Lemons. Southside Hold'em was the phrase written in neon in Lemon's lab, Slab, and after he died, it became the name of his memorial screw tape, which illuminates the importance of the slab to Lemon's identity. And after the tape was released, Southside Hold'em became a popular phrase in the Southside, so it moved beyond its slab origins. Now, growing up in Hiram Clark and going to school in the Southwest, seeing slabs was a common occurrence for me. I would see them swerving from lane to lane in a seemingly confused but obviously directed manner. I would also see them stationary, supporting the weight of their owners as they chopped game with friends and other slab riders. Now, even as an outsider, I knew that slabs represented something special. I knew that their history and meaning was much deeper than their material components. And it's this deep history and meaning that we're going to discuss today. So that being said, I want to introduce our esteemed panelists. First, Lil Randy, member of the legendary Screwed Up Clique. He is also the co-host of Damage Control Radio on 90.1 KPFT, along with DJ Chill and Young Zeke.
Right.
Already.
Yeah.
The air is Wednesday night, so tune in. ESG, also a member of the Screwed Up Clique. Since his 1994 debut, Ocean of Funk, he has released over 10 albums, the most recent being 2011's Owner's Manual. You can also hear him on that popular Drake Hell Yeah Fucking Right remix, which is hot. And my favorite, piece of ESG artistry is when he played Action in the Dirty Third. I had to shout that out. And finally, Eddie Kennedy is the owner and operator of Third Coast Customs, which is a car modification shop. Kennedy has worked with several Houston-based rappers, including Paul Wall, ESG, Slim Thug, and many others. So, give a round of applause. Now, to begin, slab is a term that is usually used pretty liberally nowadays. ESG and slab music, you mentioned that people are putting swangas on anything and calling it a slab. So in your opinion and the other panelists, what are the components of a true traditional slab?
Anybody?
I'll start. Y'all know I like to talk. back, I would say at the beginning time, more than likely it was an old school car. You know what I'm saying? It couldn't be an old Datsun, Nissan. It had to be big, you know, preferably. It didn't have to be just Cadillac. Could have been Buicks. I'm talking about, there were so many different brands of cars. I'm talking about it could be a Ford, anything. But it had to be not real big, but kind of big. I say smallest may have been a Cutlass I could think of back then. Maybe just probably the smallest car. Some people tended to keep them, if your car was real nice already, you know, with value. You lose a lot of value once you paint a car. But if you had a classic car and it was of some significant value, some people didn't necessarily have to paint it for it to be considered a slab. You know, you still could have your 84s, which are the rims, the poke out, 83s for those who didn't have the 84s. There's a difference in those by about $2,000 back then. You know what I'm saying? Like the 83s were more common. You could get the 83s, I'm just guessing, but back then, probably about, maybe about, what, about three?
About 25,000
back then. But the 84s, at one time, you had to pay. I remember one time, I think somebody was selling some foes for like $7,000 or
$8,000. They went up to
$10,000. I mean, I actually bought a pair that was $10,000.
Okay, that was $10,000. So you guys have to think, in today's society and economy, a pair of $10,000 rims are like the best you can find. So if you go back 10, 15 years, that was almost like paying $20,000 for a pair of rims. And I said this earlier, you could not be an average Joe with a set of 84s. They might let you make it with a pair of 83s, but you couldn't be the average Joe with a set of 84s. That's why if you didn't have a garage, a lot of young cats in the hood actually would invest in storages and actually would have to park their car in the storage. I don't care how prominent your neighborhood was. Yeah, you know, we thought Pearland was prominent. You know, we all moved to Pearland. I made it. You still could not park a set of swingers in the yard the way you can nowadays. So,
but the main purpose then was the fact that they only made them in production in 1983 and 1984.
That was
and
it.
And they were discontinued.
Exactly.
So you could not find those wheels anywhere. And there was only one local guy here that actually started going around across the world and actually remanufacturing these wheels, putting them together, and also re-chroming them and actually selling them to mainly like what we would say D-boys, because at that time, you couldn't get no one to spend $10,000 on a 1984 pair of wheels because they was actually that old. But the guy would restore them and put them back out there. That's what really got it started.
And that's why now you can see them everywhere because they're being manufactured again, but the value of them has right. went down. You know what I'm saying? So, but back then it was a privilege to ride on them. And like you said, this is Eddie. Eddie, you know, I'm a rapper. Eddie does slabs. You know, this, he can tell you the inside, the outside. And well, I'm, you know, I'm just giving you from the hood perspective, a point of view, how we looked at him growing up. He's gonna give you the guy who puts them together from that point of view. You know what I'm saying? So, and back then, of course, you had to have candy paint.
Yeah.
Unless you had a classic car. If it was classic, you really didn't have to paint it. You know, mm-hmm. but you had to have candy paint. And like you said, Southside did ride red, but every hood had their own color. There was no gang affiliation at all back then. If you was from Yellowstone, you probably rode a gold yellowish color. You know what I'm saying? People in Harm Clark, they used to really ride candy orange a lot. You know what I'm saying? You had people, I know a lot of people off MAK who rode candy green. I think those were the main colors, right?
Yeah,
you had a couple of people who stick out. Like
Cloverland, they rode black.
Bonnie Boys, Cloverland rode black.
Right.
Some people, you know, would just go out the way and have purple here there. You know what I'm saying? But purple was clean. But you know what I'm saying? That was the thing. And back then, the paint used to be like what? 45?
Back then, it started at like 37, go up to $6,000.
Yeah, you used to go to Jack or Ike. Jack is no longer open. Now it's Ike. If you, you know, I see the commercials nowadays, you know, and I'd be like, you know, I got a scratch on the front of my truck. And I'd be seeing those Mako commercials, and they'd be like, you know, $250. People in the hood do not understand. Going to Mako was like the ultimate no-no.
Yes.
You know, you could not go to Mako and get you no candy paint. You know what I'm saying? So
it was more bragging rights.
You go ahead and tell them the inside in case, you know, some of y'all. I know there's a couple of professors you might want you to slab. You know what I'm saying?
Because Mako, they would literally paint your car with it still wrecked.
Like, yeah, they would actually just paint over the dents and get you out of there. But the whole purpose of candy, what it is actually called an iridescent paint. It's actually three colors that are actually combined to one. Like in Houston, you see a lot of the popular colors, the red, the blues, the greens. Well, what you really see is there's a ground coat that goes underneath it. They have like 12 different bases you can pick. But normally in Houston, everybody usually goes with the silver base because it's like, if you take a silver base and you put the candy red overlay over the silver, it gives you one of the brightest reds that you can get. And also the same way with the green, with the blue. So that's why you tend to see a lot of those colors. But there's also like 12 different colors you can choose from that, like, say for instance, I can take a candy red and put a dark gray base over the car. And once I spray the red over the car, the whole entire car will become burgundy, but it's actually red over gray. And whenever the sunlight hits it, it's like it actually reflects through the base. Whenever you see a color that's red or blue, you actually, there's no flakes in the blue. It's actually the base underneath. The blue is almost like a Kool-Aid color. It's like colored with no pigments in it. You can see straight through the base, and it actually reflects the base underneath. And that's what gives you that glamour, the high, high gloss glamour, which a factory paint job will never give you that. Whenever we do a factory paint job, we have like a color code that we go by that's done by the factory, that all we do is take the color code off the car, bring it to the paint store and they mix up the paint. Say if it's red or blue, all the metallic flakes, everything is all in one. Once we paint it, we just put the clear coat on it and you're done. But the candy is totally different. We usually, some candies, depending on how wet you want to get it, the car maker could be painted at least four or five times, over and over, over, of just layers and layers of, not the base, but the candy. Because like, say if you go red or blue, the more colors you, darker, the darker you go over the car, the darker the color gets. But whenever the sunlight hits it, it's actually glowing through the base. And that's what gives you that glamour color. But that's what separates you away from a regular paint job. Because candy is consists of a lot of clear coat to where you can compare to a regular base coat, clear coat paint job. Because on a base coat, clear coat, you may have maybe one or two coats of clear and that's it. Versus a candy, we may spend at least a gallon of just clear on the car itself. But it also gets painted more than one time. So you actually look into the paint than actually looking at it. But it's so extremely wet to where, like what Pimp C used to always say, you know it's candy whenever you can look at a car and you can actually see the clouds going through the paint and actually being able to get the depth out of it. That's what you don't really see a lot of no more. But that's the thing about candy. That's what separates candy away from the regular paint jobs. And that's the reason why it costs more than just what a regular paint job would do. And the fact that the timing of it, it's not like you can just bring a car in and paint it and you out in a week or so. With the amount of steps and stages that goes into it, you know, a car could be gone for at least 6 to 8 months. But on top of that, normally when you put a slab together, you start with the engine first. We work your way out the engine, then you work your way into the interior. And then it's your preference on for it music-wise. Some people like Pioneer, some people like Sony, whatever preference you like for stereo equipment, that's what you decide or what you want to put in it. And then if you have an image that you want to portray, whenever we get the car, we actually sit you in the car, go over everything. You can make your console, or you can add your television, navigation system. One guy actually ordered a fish tank in the back of his car. I mean, it's actually whatever your preference is. But in Houston, our trend is weird because there's one car that we all mimic. There's a 1990 Cadillac, the white one is on the side. That was the last year they made that Cadillac, and it has the moldings that go on the side, and it had the European headlights. What guys are doing in Houston is they'll take a Buick. They'll take a Buick Oldsmobile, like an Olds 88, and they want the whole entire front end of a Cadillac on their car, including the front bumper, including the headlights, including the side moldings. Once we paint the car, put the fifth wheel on it, do all the interior, when the car leaves, as if you was to see it going down the street, you would actually think it's a Cadillac coming your way, when in actuality, it's a Buick. That's one of our major trends that we do out here in Houston. A lot of.
So we might let them take us through the steps. You know, you can put the prices, you know what I'm saying? So you say, since you're going to tell them, what's the steps? What's the first step? Is the engine.
The first step is the engine, because you don't want to have a nice car on the side.
What's the
road
base price of somebody putting
well,
together
an
engine?
Depending on the vehicle, because I mean, sometimes you can get lucky to find a vehicle that's in real excellent condition to begin with, but then we have some guys that they'll find a car that was like, they got off of eBay, that's been sitting in a junkyard, and you basically have to tear the car completely apart, and if it have any rust in it or whatever, everything has to be reworked and brought back out before we can even start doing any kind of painting on the car.
Okay, then we go from the motor to
then to the interior.
What you do on the interior? Explain the interior for me.
Depending if you do a convertible, you got to redo the top, redo the seats. And then normally in Houston, what we do is, say for instance, we have a 60 model Cadillac. We may tend to go to Cadillac dealership and spend 2011, like it's 2011 now, and purchase the whole insides of out of a new model DTS. And then we modify those seats to fit in that old classic car.
What that price range be about?
It all varies, but I mean, that's the thing. The thing nowadays, since the new generation is coming along, back in the day, it used to be bragging rights. Like Fat Pat used to always say, if you hear all his songs, it was always about bragging rights, mm-hmm. what you spend on your car. It ain't the year model car, it's what you spend on it. So whenever you actually pull up to an event, when people come out and look at it, they can mm-hmm. see the type of work that you actually got into the car. Mm-hmm. But now there's a lot of fly-by shops that are just throwing a lot of stuff together.
The recession.
So if I have gray vinyl inside, and I want peanut butter since, you know, we used to be tight white. You know, that used to be the white leather inside. Uh-huh. Nowadays, it's more you want gray or peanut butter. Mm-hmm. About how much it costs
varies
to get.
Varies like on something like that, because it starts off around $3,500 on up, depending on how extravagant you get with it.
Okay.
Also, whenever we redo design the interior, we can actually redesign it to fit you.
Right.
If you might like red and green, or you might like red with blue with white piping.
Okay.
You know, all that varies.
Dive in real quick. I got a few more questions. That's all great stuff. Uh-huh. But I want to get into the history of slab culture a little bit. Mm-hmm. So can you talk about when you all saw your first slabs and who drove slabs in these early days?
Hear you.
Can't hear me? Mic on? Okay, here we go. Sorry. Can you talk about when you saw your first slab?
Honestly,
and who drove slabs in these early days?
I don't know if this man here was the first guy I see to have a candy slab on the album cover. Okay. That actually promoted me to want to be able to get with the rappers, to be able to offer that type of look, you know, for him to take it on a national level.
Okay. Yeah, so my first time really seeing him, I would say around 91.
91, 92.
You know, that's when I was, you know, first started seeing him. And around 93, I had a homeboy. It was a car fanatic, you know what I'm saying? And he knew where to get all the great seats, you know what I'm saying? Back then, they used to ride Recaro seats. Mm-hmm. They used to call them Ricks. You know, you could swerve them around. Had the little mesh at the top, you know what I'm saying? So he was the first person I seen put together one, you know, from top to bottom.
What do you mean put together? I mean from the engine, from the interior, to custom sounds, to actually have an actuator to where you can raise the trunk open with the switch from the inside, and the fifth will recline back. And even with the fifth wheels, normally when they come together, they don't even have like it just has a hubcap in there. Yeah. So we actually take a real original rim, cut it in half, add lugs to weld bolts, and make the rim fit exactly like a hubcap. But it's actually a rim. And we can do up to sizes 15 on up to 22s inside the bumper kit.
That's why the same car that's on the Ocean Swangin' and Bangin' video is actually white in the video, because my homeboy had just got it. You know, it was drop top of the wrist, and he bought it white, mm-hmm. Boom. Put the white insides, painted candy red, threw the folds on it. Mm-hmm. That was my first time.
My first time, I probably was in the ninth grade. I seen a Monte Carlo. It had Rick Ricardo's on it. It was 83s, 84s, I can't really say, but when I saw it, I was just like, man, that's what I want. And that's pretty much how, you know, our culture is. Like, it's just something about elbows, about swingers that just, you know, make us stand out on our own. And really, I just kind of want to touch on the subject of the word slab, because I know a lot of people really don't understand where that word come from or what's the meaning of it. You know, it's not slow, loud, and banging. That's a slab. the root word, slab is actually a root word. Comes from concrete slab. Yeah.
Exactly.
It's like back in the days when two people were talking, and if I was talking to E, I'd be like, man, I'm finna hit that slab, meaning my car finna come out the shop and it's about to be on the concrete slab. But now people just take the root word of it and say slab, but it really was just meaning I was finna be on the streets.
And meaning one thing when he said slab was, by the time you add the custom music to the car, the low profile tires to the car, it actually lowered the vehicle. It wasn't a low rider like a, you know, with hydraulics and nothing, but it just gave it a lower level look versus than what the factory was. So that's one of the reasons why we said slab.
Right.
You know.
Okay. And on DJ Screw's Wineberry Over Gold, Fat Pat spit an almost 10-minute freestyle that addressed tension between the north side and south side of Houston over slabs. So can you talk about how slabs became a point of conflict between the two sides? And what was the role of the Screwed Up Clique's music in the beef?
Because, like we said earlier, we have people who are involved in the streets, you know what I'm saying? At the time, like we say, the rims, 84s were $10,000. You know, you're spending $4,500 on paint, spending this on your inside. If you got $30,000 or $40,000 to put in the car, you know, and more than likely, you were not a doctor. You know, you may have been dealing with prescribed pharmaceuticals, but you were not a doctor. Mm-hmm. So, therefore, that tends to put you in an environment where illegal things are going on. So, with that being said, you had these cats from these hood who ran with this guy with this slab, these cats from this hood who might have ran with this guy with this slab. So what would happen was a lot of times people didn't want to steal in their own out their own backyard. You know, they knew, you know, they couldn't go down here and steal pop it from 3-4 action car. You know, he's gonna pistol whip you, for example. So what they would do is go to the club. When they at the club, they looking and they watching. They see in the slab line, oh, who that is? Where they from? Oh, them boys from the 4th. Oh, they from 3rd Ward. Oh, they from 5th Ward. And immediately, if you're not from that area, that neighborhood, boom, now they gonna get somebody to jump in the undercover. What we call undercovers is another word for just a regular car. Like, it used to be a word people would say hoopty. Yeah. You know, in the hood, we would say hoop, but we never say hoopty down here. It was always hopping the hoop or hopping the undercover. That being a normal car, 9 times out of 10, your undercover would have tint. You would actually look like an undercover police. That's where the word came from. So they would follow you and find out what hood, what street, or where you're from. So what happened was there was so many slabs on the south side. There was a lot of cats from the north side. I cannot think of the neighborhood in particular, but
Rosewood.
Rosewood, that's what it was. Yes, they were always, you know, they just took it on themselves like, you know, them little cats from the south side riding slab, I'm going to take them up off that slab. So that's was when the tension became real big because, you know, they would come, a car gets stolen on the south side, and it would be found stripped on the north side. And, you know, it's like certain things of a car people will remember, you know, like some people would be happy to ride a slab. He may have just a black Lincoln with a candy red fifth wheel on it, with the bumper kit, the fifth wheel.
Yeah.
So, you know, dude see him at the club, like, man, that's my damn fifth wheel. Like, you sure? Like, yeah, that's my fifth wheel. I mean, it was scratched right there. That's my fifth wheel. So, next thing you know, guns are drawn, violence is here, and now it's, you know, it's real tension. Then it got to the point where the south side, you know, some cat may be from Third Ward, get his car stole. The dude who stole his car may be from Heim Clark. But what they would do would strip it on the north side. So now it's like you going around like, man, dude from the north side stole my damn car. The whole time it's somebody right from Heim Clark or somewhere. You know what I'm saying? So it became a real big division between the south and the north. So some people would get on the screw tape and might just shoot a slug. What we say by shoot a slug is a subliminal hatred towards someone. You know what I'm saying? Without just directly saying, I don't like the dude with the big beard. I would be like, I you know what I'm saying? I'd be like, man, them big bills be getting on my nerve. But you're not telling it. So they would get on the screw tapes, you know what I'm saying? It might be like, you know, so-and-so over there, you know, y'all ain't ride like we ride, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da. But so like you the say, city got divided. That's why I actually did a song with Slim Thug, because I was like, you know, it's time to bring a little peace among the north and the south side. That's how we all hooked up.
And at the time, it's just the fact that the rims were not available. And
exactly.
What made the south side stood out more than the north was it's a very minor difference in the 83 and 84, but it's a big difference. And the thing about it was, because of the 84s were costing $10,000, the most people that had those rims were the guys that was on the south side. So the guys that was on the north side, they had the 83s, but then whenever they went to go get their rims repaired, they want to change the scenario up, was they were calling their 83s 84s.
Mm-hmm.
When actuality, they were 83s because Kiki, other guys like Corey Blunt, that would have like 12 vehicles that's totally customized, and every wheel that he got on his car, he has the 84s, which is $10,000 a set. And there was one cat that put a Park Ave together. Yes. He actually put 6 wheels. He put 4 in a car, 1 in a bumper kit, 1 on the trunk. So you're looking at $20,000 just the wheels, but with the rims on one car. And then it became made him a target because at the time, you couldn't find these wheels nowhere. And if you rode 84s, 84s was like the epitome. I mean, yeah. You know.
Like
you,
a Bentley.
Yeah. You know. You had 84s, that was it. Now, 83s, you can get by, but whenever you rode and you seen an 84, and mainly the difference is whenever the rim actually rolled, an 84 had a little more gap in between it, which made the rim look more open. An 83 looks smaller on the inside and a little more shorter, which everybody compared it to the 30 spoke, you know, because it didn't stick as far out of the car. But that's what really got the 84s on the uproar for where the prices jumped from. At one point, they were like five, then they went to 10 grand because you couldn't find them anywhere.
And you know how you hear on the news when, you know, maybe like kids are killing over Jordans? You know what I'm saying? They be like, oh, they got to stop this. If you wasn't in the culture or know about the history of it, It was, I'm talking about, a real privilege to ride on the set of 84s. It just made you feel like, you know, you were George Bush. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Seriously. You know what I'm saying? Obama. You was the president of your hood. Even women knew that boy on 84.
Exactly.
Women knew this. You know what I'm saying? So
you couldn't buy them in a store. You couldn't buy them off of eBay. You couldn't buy them nowhere. I mean, it was just obsolete.
So can you talk about how slab culture has developed, grown, or changed over the years? What were cars like back in the early days compared to how they are now?
The difference is now is everything is duplicated, is manufactured. You know, back then, everything was original. Like, the elbow back in the day actually was a Cadillac rim. Cadillac produced the rim. Cadillac made the rim. Now it's any mojo making the rim. You know what I'm saying? It's at a mass production, so it's like, it really has no value to the rim anymore, you know what I'm saying? It made even the older rim, the original rim, not have value. Like, now, when you could sell $10,000 for a pair of 84s, the original ones, a person wouldn't give you $1,000 for them now because they're not worth anything anymore
because
the mass production of the new ones now.
I guess maybe after 4 years now, there's a company that's been out that actually remanufactured the wheels, and then what they ended up doing, they went from the standard size was only 15 inch, but they went up. Well, actually, they made a 14. A lot of people don't understand that.
They got
it. 14 and 15 inch. That was it. But now the company that came in, they make 14, 15 inch, 17 inch, 20, and 22. And then now they're actually making them to where the spokes are going further out.
Yeah,
so it's
these
like it
super
the whole
pokers,
and gorillas, orangutan. And it's crazy because now all the swanger, when we call them, it was just elbows. Now, they got animal names to them, and giraffe necks.
I think really because of us coming in age, it's like we still stuck on what we used to seeing when we were coming up.
Right.
But now the newer generation has jumped in, and they like cars like Grand Prix, Pontiacs, something we wouldn't even dare put a set of wheels on.
Right.
But now that they're in production, it's like, what can you do? The best way I look at it with the way I design my cars is the complete detail. I mean, no matter what you put on a car, it's gonna come to how far out you go with it and how detailed you get with it. And plus, what we used to have is taking a person's ideal and putting it into the car.
Exactly.
Only that person's ideal, not his buddies around the corner, not someone else's. So that way, when he pull up to an event, his car gonna stand out way different than anybody else. It may be the same color, but then when you pop the trunk,
gonna have
one
different
of his slogans in it. I mean, you know, something to where it's totally different than the average person.
And it's like getting a pair of swangers now is like going to Walmart.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They're everywhere.
Not Walmart,
so,
flea market.
So the value, the value, of course, has decreased. And that's something else. You would always see nowadays, because they don't go by like the so-called slab rules. You hear them with the slab rules.
Exactly.
What's the first thing you're supposed to fix?
Yeah.
The engine. Now, tell me, how many of you have never, you always see a candy red car, a blue car, some swaggers broke down. You know what I'm saying? Because they don't go by it. They don't go by the rules no more. So I got a little nephew. He's a senior this year. I'm talking about he worked. He had him a little part-time job all year. You know, I never knew what it was for. He just used to talk. Da, 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 da. He said, man, I'm ready. I said, ready for what? Get my swaggers. So, you know what I'm saying? They just putting them on anything. Mustangs. You know, I told y'all I seen one on a PT Cruiser.
Mitsubishi.
I could not believe that. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking about, like, cars like that. Like, when we, you know, very few people would put them on Benzes. You know what I'm saying? Like, you saw a few people who put them on Benzes.
That was more of a cap thing.
That was more of like, I can do that.
I can do that. Like,
yeah, I can take my back off.
You know what I'm saying? So. It's changed totally different, you know. Back then, like you say, slab was for special occasions. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know now, cause a young guy, you know, he's still in school. You know, he's not too well off financially, so he has to drive this car that he's put all his money into to school, to work every day. You know what I'm saying? So
and that's a big no-no.
You know, it's totally different now, man.
So to close out, can each of you talk about why you personally decided to ride slab? What does it mean to you personally?
I mean,
why y'all look at me? you started everything.
All right, I go, man. Well, for me personally, it's because, I mean, for one thing, it kind of made you the man in your hood, you know, and everybody want to be the man, or I would hope so. And that's basically why I did it. You know, half of the slab, anytime that I did buy a slab or whatever, was just basically showing out. You know what I'm saying? Just showing, you know, I could do this. Or, you know, that's basically what it was. You know what I'm saying? And I enjoy riding looking good. So, I mean, that's all it was to it.
I guess times have kind of changed a little bit. You know what I'm saying? It would be very hard for me to, you know, really want to go put $20,000 to $30,000 into a slab.
Oh, I wouldn't dare do that. I mean, Kiki, I'm gonna tell you right now. Kiki said the best line ever in rap about a slab. He said, "On the cool, it's a bad investment," and that was the truth. That was the best line I ever heard about a slab. It is a bad investment. Once you put all that money into a car, it's not worth nothing. Especially once you paint it, it's not worth nothing. You know what I'm saying? But it looked good, but it's not worth nothing.
But before you have, you know, a son, you know what I'm saying? Before you have mortgages, you know what I'm saying? All that, it'd be cool, you know what I'm saying? So, you know what I'm saying? I think it just kind of changed nowadays. Yeah. When anybody can ride a slab, everybody rides swangers. You know, they consider it ride a slab. We don't, you know what I'm saying? We just look at them. I'm talking about it's a joke, you know what I'm saying? I think with growing up, getting more responsibilities, it just, you know, you just kind of shy away from it. For one thing, there's always racial profiling with a slab.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't care what color you are, white, black, Hispanic.
And I remember back in the day, it didn't matter. Back in the day, everybody used to put white interior in your car, and white interior signified to the police that you was a drug dealer.
Yeah, it's straight racial profile.
Straight racial profile. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I got pulled over so many times with white interior. I had to change it. I mean, it wasn't even worth it.
So I like riding like I'm riding. But they can't tell, you know what I'm saying?
All right, I'm going to let you close it out, Eddie Kennedy.
Okay, me, since I do it for a living, I still have a passion for it. So, I mean, despite the racial profiling and all that goes along with it, I still continue to do it. But I do see a big change in from how we used to customizing cars to what guys want nowadays. And I tend to try to stay away from it because I still want to be the one to keep the old classics still going, you know, with the old Cadillacs, the old Buicks, you know, done well. I'd rather fix one car from this neighborhood than to do 10 green cars for one line.
Right.
Then also, like Fat Pat said the most, you have to take pride in your ride. A lot of people nowadays, they don't want to take pride in their ride. And the enjoyment that I get out of it, if I get an old car that's in real bad condition, you might come to the shop and be like, "Man, are y'all planning on parting this car out?" And I'd be like, "Nah, it's gonna actually get fixed." Mm-hmm. And then seeing the end result of knowing what it came from to what we bring it to, it's still an enjoyment to me. So I still enjoy the slab culture. But like I said, it has changed tremendously from our era to where it is now. But a lot of people, if they can relate to the first blueprint that I can remember, other than the ESG with the swinging and banging, was 8-Ball MJG when they made that song, "It's Like Candy." If you really listen to that song, he basically break down everything that goes on in Houston. Because the purpose of us fixing the slab together was, on a good sunny Sunday, we get cleaned up, watch the car get cleaned up, We might just turn a couple. We might have no destination to ride, but we will hit MLK. You hit MLK, you might see 12, 13, 15 other fixed up rides.
You didn't even have to have on a fresh outfit.
You know what I'm saying?
I remember this. You know what I'm saying? My OGs would hop out with slippers.
You know what I'm saying?
And pull all the girls.
I have to cut it down. Right? Okay. I hope you've learned that Slabs, long history, rich culture. I want to thank Lil Randy, ESG, definitely Eddie Kennedy.
If y'all want one?
Yeah, go see Eddie Kennedy.
Third Coast
Customs. All right, thank you.
Still going down.
We're going to talk about syrup because it's so closely associated with Houston. It's associated with the Screwed Up Click, with a lot of Houston rappers. And so I felt like we could not have a conference on Houston hip hop without addressing it. But the way I want us to address it is basically with the attitude that we're all grown folks here, and we're just gonna talk a little about what it is, the context of it, kind of the history of how it came into the culture. I think we can bring someone with a health background who can tell us a little about it, and then people who maybe know a little about it themselves, and I'll sit down and talk. And that is the beautiful thing about a university, is that we can do that. Mm-hmm. So our first speaker, or our speaker for this panel, is Dr. Ronald J. Peters. Dr. Peters is an associate professor of behavioral sciences at University of Texas Health Science Center at Houston School of Public Health. Dr. Peters has held faculty appointments at the University of Houston, Houston Baptist University, Prairie View A&M University, and Texas Southern University. He also served as the director of the Historically Black College and University Applied Research Initiative with the Southwest Prevention Center and was principal investigator of the Houston Arrestee Drug Abuse Monitoring Program, funded through the National Institute of Justice. Dr. Peters' impressive background includes the fact that he has published over 75 peer-reviewed papers, and his research has been featured on ABC News, CBS News, CNN, ESPN, USA Today, on and on. So I'm gonna move over to the panel to help moderate after he speaks, but please welcome Dr. Ronald J. Peters.
$50 a pop.
Before we start, I just want to play something from that'll be a prelude, so to say, from the last presentation. That's one of my favorite songs, if y'all don't mind. If y'all could hear it. Y'all know that? Y'all not used to professors hearing my candy. But I got that in my little, phone that I keep with me when I'm driving, down the slab. Herbie Hancock, who was really one of the founding fathers of hip-hop music, through some of his works with Watermelon Man and Headhunters, has stated about his mentor, Miles Davis, that Miles was great for a lot of reasons. But one reason why he was great was because when any of us were out of key, he never said you're bad, he never said you're out of the band, he never said what are you doing, he did something totally different. He just made music out of whatever he was given. And that's the lesson in itself. And when I think about hip hop music, screw music, taking something out of nothing and making music out of whatever you're given. That's what this conference and that's what hip-hop music is about. Now, just to talk a little bit about codeine promethazine. I got my box. I'll show you all of the little things. But codeine promethazine really didn't start in the 90s. It got popular, codeine promethazine. But when you want to look back into the 60s, they had Robitussin. Back in the days, and it was in Third Ward, and they would sell it in a place called the Alley, and went for about $2.50. And then they would cut it with beer back in the days. And then, of course, what happened in the 90s is codeine promethazine became something that was widely spread throughout Houston and diffused throughout the United States. Codeine promethazine is wanted compared to other forms of codeine because it has three different substances in it. It has, number one, alcohol, and again, that's a depressant. Number two, it has promethazine, which is an antihistamine. And for those who've ever had a common cold, which is everybody in here, again, it makes you drowsy. And then it has an opiate, which is the codeine. So when you put in all of those things together, you know, it has a unique taste and substance. Now, a lot of times, hip-hop music has been put as being the cause of course, the spread of all kinds of things. But this is not true. We need to thank God for these hip-hop artists for letting us know what was going on in the community. And for people like myself that's a professor or parents or whatever, you don't need to go and go into the community. You don't even need to ask your children what's going on in the community. All you need to do is listen to hip-hop, and hip-hop will tell you the answers. And it's not just hip-hop, it's African-American music, where it goes back to Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, coming forth to carry me home. Y'all like my little Southern background? You know what I'm saying? Give me some love, y'all. Again, what they're saying is bring the boats back. Bring the boats back. There were slaves that were singing these particular, this particular music to give, again, they, if they stated these things publicly, they would be punishment. But the reality was bring the boats back. And when you look at hip-hop music, whether it be from the Memphis Jug Band to, you know, Pig Meat Martin back in the days, first rhymers to ever rhyme, our culture is based on telling messages in music. And that's what Houston was doing in telling the world what was going on amongst our children. So who are the real issues with this particular problem? Some of y'all, if I say some names, you'll know. High tech, you know, our farmer, activists, qual tests, the nasty stuff, and somebody'll smile in here if you know what I'm saying. MGP, that's when you really want to just drink something. But nobody really wants the MGP unless they have to get it. Back in the days, a PT Cruiser used to cost about $100, which is a pint, back in 93. When I came here as a young professor, young person going to graduate school. I grew up in the crack epidemics. So again, when I came here and I went to the schools in Houston, I would see kids that were drinking out of one Sprite. And I said, why is it 10 people drinking out of one Sprite bottle? And then why you have some simps, and some of the men up here know what I'm talking about, where everybody in a public bathroom, you would want to go to the bathroom, and everybody was having diarrhea because they was getting corn syrup. You know, it was getting that K-Ro. And you had an endemic in Houston where you had, the worst thing you can do if you went to a public school would be to go sit down on the toilet. And you had kids that were sitting down on the toilet like crazy. We had an endemic. At the time, it cost about, like I said, $100, but for an ace now, which is an ounce, it costs about the same, 100 to 140, just depending on if it's a syrup drought or not. Now, Hippocrates said on air, waters, and places, Hippocrates, he said that you have to look at the air, the pandemics, the epidemics, the endemics, and again, what's happening is that when you look at the real people that's selling this, which is the distributors and these particular pharmaceutical companies, why are we getting the same amount of cough medicine in the wintertime, in the summertime that you're getting it in the wintertime? Why would that happen? Who's really getting paid? Used to be a place called Bar, a pharmaceutical company. That used to be the premium codeine promethazine that you can buy in 93. Why isn't nobody talking about Bar anymore? I'm going to tell you why. Because my man Edwin Cohen, who owned this particular pharmaceutical company, sold out, got out the game, made a lot of money off of codeine promethazine, sold it to another company, Teva Pharmaceuticals, for $8 billion. And check this out. Then told Teva to take this $1.5 billion that I owe in debt, and you take that too. That's how much money he made off of the game. So when you want to really look at the people who's really involved with putting this stuff out, we don't need to look at, again, hip-hop. We need to thank hip-hop for what they did to let the world know this was an endemic that spread throughout the world. Now, another way that it was put on, and then we'll talk to have all of us talk together, was doctors. Now, when you look out here, the major pharmacy school for the southern part of the United States is Texas Southern University Pharmacy School. And back in the days, what they would do is go, and once they graduate, you would have mom and pop pharmacies in the hood. Now, when you go back to 93, it was a place called Eckerd's. All right? If you wanted to get some pharmaceuticals, you had to go to Eckerd's. Eckerd's didn't put pharmacies in black neighborhoods. You had to go in the medical center or somewhere else. And then all of a sudden, Walgreens. Hey, guess what? Black people and people of color, they have diseases. Oh, really? Let's put some pharmacies in their neighborhoods. Now you have these people who had the mom and pop pharmacies back in the 90s that are struggling because everybody's going to pay and go to Walgreens that they can get aspirin. Instead of having three different types of aspirin, you can have 20 different types of aspirin. And then you can pay a dollar less. So now I'm struggling. For the students that are out here, you took a 101 psychology class, and they talked about Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You don't know what you're capable of doing if your kids need to eat. You don't know what you're capable of doing if you need to eat. You'll be surprised what you're capable of doing. So a lot of the doctors and a lot of the pharmacists got together in the hood, and they started saying, hey, don't go to Walgreens. They have something to lose. Go ahead and flip these scripts and take them to the mom and pop spot. And I'm telling you, if my kids need to eat, I may look the other way too. Just keep them coming in, as long as I can keep my kids going to school. So you had crooked doctors, but then you had the doctors that just didn't have knowledge of what was going on. And then when you look at the symptoms of a cough, really, when doctors, when you go in, they ask you for a history, and then they look for symptoms. And you had so many people that were telling their own kids, boy, when you go up in there, you better act like you coughing. Because they were syrup heads, bottom line. This is liquid codeine, liquid heroin. It's an opiate. And they had their kids running to try to get this stuff. Everybody remembers what was going on with Dr. Syrup on Southmore back in the days. A line, when it's 102 degrees weather, and you got a line of 200 people outside wanting to wait to get some health care. This is what was going on. I'm not going to talk very long, but I'd like to thank, you know, number one, the hip-hop artists for spreading the word for not just youth, but for families and for America, for us to know what's going on. And even if you're just a professor in here or someone is just working at U of H, just part of this program that Sister Grove put together, you know what? Listen to hip-hop. You know, because it's going to tell you everything that you need to know. And if you're a parent, listen to hip-hop so you can talk to your kids. Because all it's doing is just like with Swing Low Sweet Chariot, is giving you a message on what's going on in the community. So I'm going to sit down, and again, thank y'all for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Peters. I really appreciate having your perspective today. And we're going to keep this panel a little bit short, just because we're running a little behind. I'll go ahead and start while Dr. Peters is getting kind of settled. I want to ask, let me ask you, ESG. Okay, when Screw started slowing down his tapes, when you first went over to his house, was Syrup in the picture yet?
Yeah, you know, my dad told me he used to sell. You know what I'm saying? The reason it got big because the people who was making the tapes was saying, hey, this is what I do. So every, like I said earlier, every neighborhood has certain people who the whole neighborhood looked up to, because it wasn't about religion. It was all about the mighty dollar. So if Joe Blow got all the bread in the neighborhood and this is what he do, a lot of people listening and hearing what he do. So that's why, you know, I think the spread of it became so big. And, you know, I'm just telling you, the reason it spread, because of the taste. You feel me? There's a lot of things you could put out there. You could put out there, there's a brand new restaurant on so-and-so. You need to go try it out. If everybody go try it out, nobody likes it, it's not going to last. The taste was something that people were not, because at first they used to mix it with Boone's Farm, which are like a wine cooler. Once people stopped worried about the Boone Farm and started mixing with the sodas, it just became a taste that was so addictive, and it just was a cool thing to do. You was not looked at in a bad light, especially in the Houston area, if you, what we say, if you sip. You know what I'm saying? That's why it became big. It had nothing to do with screw music, because they weren't playing, they're not playing screw music right now in Atlanta. And it's an epidemic in Atlanta. They love it. They're not playing screw music in New York, in Harlem. They sipping in Harlem. They're not playing it in California. California pretty much passed Houston up with like he said, the crooked doctors. Every doctor in California has a pharmacy open with paints now. It's the taste.
Randy, I can't speak to that. Randy, what's your perspective about that, as in the relationship of the start of Screw slowing down music?
I mean, well, no. When I first met Screw, syrup wasn't even around. Like, we was, you know what I'm saying? It was pretty much just beer, liquor, and stuff like that. You know, but then, like, around the early 90s, syrup did come into the picture. It was pretty much just, like, what we was doing, and you know what I'm saying? I really don't know how I just got introduced to nobody, but you know, you just looked up and that's what we was doing. You know, it was real, like when it first came about, it was easy. Like you could walk in front of a police officer with this styrofoam cup with you could have like almost a whole pint in there. And he would smell it and give you your cup back. Well, he wouldn't even smell it. I mean, you can smell it coming out the cup automatically, but he would just give your cup back. Now, if you had, like, marijuana or something like that, he'd mess with you about that. But that syrup, he wouldn't mess with you. But as we started making these screw tapes and they got real, real popular, of course, everything that was happening on the screw tape was what everybody wanted to do. You know what I'm saying? And at one time, the screw tapes really controlled every aspect of the Houston. Hood. Every aspect, you know what I'm saying? From record stores couldn't even sell their records because kids wasn't buying your tape, wasn't buying that music unless Screw had Screw. If it wasn't on Screw mixtape, they wasn't buying it. So by that being said, if everything that you listening to and you hearing like, oh yeah, what's up ESG, you're gonna wanna know who is ESG. Oh yeah, man, I'm sipping on a pint. You gonna wanna sip on a pint, because everything that's being done and said on the screw tape is what Houston wanted to do in the 90s. And with that being said, I just want people to know that it wasn't just syrup that was being talked about on the tapes. We talked about slabs. We talked about everything that we was doing. You know what I'm saying? It's just syrup is an illegal drug. You know, promethazine is an illegal drug. And when these tapes got so much at a widespread to where, you know, the law enforcement is understanding, oh, that's what they drinking. Because it even got to a point where, you know, rappers were saying, sipping bar promethazine with codeine. You know, in the beginning, they didn't know what we was talking about because we was calling it syrup. Yeah. So they didn't know if we was drinking maple syrup, pancake syrup. They didn't know what it was, you know. But then as it go on, just like now, you know, when you say codeine, and then this law enforcement heard these tapes, because you can't deny the widespread of a screw tape. Everyone has heard it, from doctors, lawyers, to whoever you are, you done heard a screw tape, if you were in the Houston area, you know what I'm saying? So by that, when it spread it like that, everybody wanted to do what was on the screw tape. So, you know, if you're doing something illegal, they know what I'm saying, and that's what made it.
80s was the crack era.
Exactly.
You know, I was a little kid. I saw my stepdad was a straight crackhead, and I was like, this was on TV. You know what I'm saying? 90s, until now, it was straight sipping. You know what I'm saying? Then it got so big by the time, okay, you got to look at, we're all making so much money as youngsters. Screw is selling 4,000 and 5,000 cassette tapes at $10 a tape. You know what I'm saying? Buying brand new cars off showroom floors with youngsters. So now we got enough bread. Like you say, he was right about the price then.
Yeah.
He looked wrong about the price now.
He was on the price now.
But he was right. It was so cheap. It was so cheap. You know what I'm saying?
And so plentiful.
The same bottle that he's going to show you, because I almost stole it out of his box. But the same, but this same, is empty. But this same bottle here, when we first started in the early 90s at Screw House, was maybe $125. You probably could pay $100. Right now, this here, you're going to pay every bit of $800. That's just the markup value of it. You know, some people are going to charge you $60 for every one that's in here. It's 16 in here. So you multiply 60 times 16, and that's the price that you'll get it at. That's over $900 right now.
And like I said, an ace, that's what I meant. An ace is called an ounce. It's about $100 now. That's what they call that ounce.
And then it's 60.
Well, you got to connect.
It was a drop. During the drop season, it was 100. It was 100 a year ago. It's back down to 60 now.
Drug wars.
We just trying to keep it real as we can keep it. There used to be a time I wouldn't even talk about this. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
It wasn't for everybody to know. But it's been on the news. It's been so out there. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, my son, fifth grade, came home, scared the hell out of me. He say, "Daddy, my homeboy Brennan say, that be cough syrup people be having in them white cups." So I was like, "Dang, you in the fifth grade? He heard this?" So, you know, I was like, "Well, I can't have no more white cups around here." All about the kids, man. Wait till you go to school.
Yeah, and the truth of the matter was, back in those days, man, in the early 90s, we were young, we were still kids, and us drinking syrup, we really didn't think it was nothing wrong about it. That's why we said it on Screw Tapes. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, even back in the day, if you did go to jail for that, you know, it wasn't really it was just a slap on the hand. You know, now you go to jail with 1 ounce. Well, they done got to the point to where if, say you got a 20-ounce soda water and you got an ounce of syrup in there, well, you're going to get charged for the whole 20-ounce because they can't separate it. Right. So now that you know that you can really go to jail for it, it's to where they ain't really talking about it on these mixtapes no more. They not really putting it out there like that, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, when we was doing it, we was young, so we did put it out there, because that's what we was doing, but we didn't really think of no consequences about it. It's just like, hey, this is what we doing, so this is what we gonna talk about, you know what I'm saying? But nowadays, this is a whole different game.
One of the things, too, that was interesting, when I first started researching this, there really weren't too many people that had knowledge of hip hop or what was going on in the community, to be honest with you, where I work, okay? And they were calling me a nutty professor because I was saying that kids were drinking syrup and we had a major endemic in Houston. And then all of a sudden, 5 or 6 years later, then you got corporate America. And this is the worst thing I've seen since candy cigarettes. Back in the days, we used to have candy cigarettes and model behaviors. But I mean, when you could take rose hips and take something called purple stuff and then prostitute hip-hop music and put melatonin in it and all these sleeping aids and so forth and have kids drinking this stuff off the streets and prostituting, taking money away from hip-hop by using their logos, everybody know what lean means, particularly about 6 or 7 years ago, and taking a name. And then check this out, even in another country, in France, if you read the back of this, this is talking about syrup. Because on the internet, a lot of people from different countries really didn't know what syrup was. And you would ask questions. All they knew back 5, 6, 7 years ago, the reality was, is hip hop music, yeah, it was big in the East, big in the West, but the center point of hip-hop music was the South, bottom line, for the last 10 years. And it diffused, and that's why you see people taking up the trends of the South in the North. They taking up codeine, promethazine, after, of course, the South did it. They taking up codeine, promethazine in Canada. They taking it up in Amsterdam, because our music here is the centerpiece of the world as far as with the particular trends of popularity. And so here you have something in France that they're manufacturing in France and saying that it's straight from the streets of Houston. And it's called syrup, and they're selling this like mad. So the people you really should get mad at are not, again, the people who are talking about this particular music, but corporate America, who's making a real big money off of this stuff and spreading it to our kids. I had a parent come up to me one day, and she had saw something I did on the news, trying to get to these guys to take this out of Texas. Yeah. And it's been off the streets, you know, because of some of the socio-political things that we've done to try to get this stuff off the streets. You don't see this in the stores as much as you used to, but it's still out there a little bit. But we're working with the Department of Health to get this stuff off the streets. And by the way, this, according to research, has been correlated with kids wanting to use codeine promethazine, meaning that kids that drink this are more likely to try the real thing. If you get bamboozled, what happens? You're gonna want the real thing, bottom line. I had a parent come up to me, she said, you know what, I was just in the store, and my kid, he said that he wanted a purple soda, so I got it for him. And I didn't know, I mean, he was tired, he went to school with this stuff, you know what I'm saying? And this is what corporate America can do to take hip-hop and the trends of hip-hop, prostitute it, and make money. And again, they talked about industry rule 1080, I think. Again, the media, corporate America, all of that together is one. You have to be very careful, and it's up to us to protect hip-hop and to protect the people like them that get blamed for simply just telling us what's going on in their hoods, bottom line.
So I wanted to follow up on something you said, Lil Randy. Was there any concern among any of you guys about whether syrup might be addictive or whether it might, you know?
No, like I said, we was kids, we was young. As a kid, you don't think of consequences or you don't think about tomorrow. It's just a way of life, you know what I'm saying? As older right now, of course, I think about what I do, I wouldn't do it, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, when I was young, I ain't think about going to jail. I ain't think sipping syrup was illegal at all. You know what I'm saying? It's just what at that time that's what was going on. So
it's almost like certain things you would, for example, no male would want to do anything that make a woman be like, ugh. You know what I'm saying? If you just really think about it, down here sipping. Women were sipping, you know what I'm saying? It was like the norm. When I say the norm, if a person was smoking marijuana, there was nothing wrong with them feeling like sipping. That's why now to this day, there's a lot of people, you know, might say, oh man, I don't smoke no more, but I sip every now and then. Because they look at it like it is so casual there's, you know what I'm saying? And just like I say, when you talk about the different people who died. They always try to, you know, gonna say, he was a sipper. But you have never physically seen an autopsy, you know what I'm saying, that says Robert Earl Davis died just only from promethazine codeine. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I don't wanna hear about four or five other drugs that you're gonna mix with it. You know what I'm saying? So in our mind, in my mind, where I come up and still where I travel the circles I'm in, sipping is just something that is the norm.
Was there ever a particular point that you remember when you realized that people like that weren't in your group, the group that Kiki described so well as the group that you were paying attention to, that they had heard about syrup from tapes, where it started kind of like a feedback back to you?
When I heard Jay-Z say something about syrup, that blew my mind. Because my thing is, when I heard Jay-Z say it, I knew he didn't really know nothing about it. Or like, when I hear certain people say something about stuff, I know he just really saying what people want to hear, you know, what's politically right, or you know what I'm saying, but he really don't know the first thing about it, you know what I'm saying? He one of those people that probably literally think we're drinking maple syrup or pancake syrup, you know, I can't see him thinking otherwise, you know what I'm saying?
I knew it was real big when Bumby went to Philly to do a song with Beanie Sigel, rap artist that was on Jay-Z's label. Bun say, as soon as he got to the studio, you know, this Beanie Sigel had paints everywhere. Like, hey, I'm sipping, baby. I'm on this H-Town doing, you know what I'm saying? So,
trying to make him feel at home.
Yeah, you know, the way to put it, man, it's just a big thing that a lot of people are brand new to that don't really know about it. That's why the Atlanta, all the hip-hop artists are rapping about it now. I'm talking about every 2 Chainz song, he got a Dirty Sprite, Magic,
Future.
For real, you know what I'm saying? Magic a lot. And then what gets taken out of context with it is when you see, say for example, a new artist, you know, as soon as he shoot his video, the first thing he's figured he got to do is go get him 2 white cups, a double cup. So now it just makes it look like every rapper in Houston sip syrup when every rapper in Houston don't, you know what I'm saying?
And that's why I felt like we had to talk about it.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? It's almost like something you just can't get
it's
away.
Like a symbol.
If you grew up in Compton, you're going to be affiliated, have relatives that are probably in the gang environment. In Houston, no matter white, Mexican, no matter what you are, somebody you know or around has been around the syrup epidemic. So it's just kind of like a title we cannot throw away. All we can do is try to educate the youngsters and the people who don't know about it to let them know that it is highly, is very, 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 very addictive. You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, it's very addictive. It tastes good, but it's addictive. And you will go to jail, just like he said, when once... like you said, 1 ounce, and when we say 1 ounce, he told you that's just 1 ounce of liquid. You will get charged with just like having 1 ounce of cocaine. That's how big it has become. Instead of the community and everybody, I've been seeing him doing this thing for a minute. He's been trying to educate people. But the other powers that be, they would rather lock you up for a lot more time for having this casual drug then lock someone up who's robbing someone or a child molester who gets 5 years in jail and you get 10 years for one bottle of syrup. I fear the police more than the syrup.
I want to sort of close with one other question. Big Mo had a lyric that I thought was really interesting. In the song Leave Drank Alone. I think he started to respond to some of the, you know, media attention on the Screwed Up Click. And he said, Big Mo ain't no role model, I'm only human. It's a shame how the world be judging us for the things that we be doing. And I kind of wanted to ask you how you felt about the fact that DJ Screw and the Screwed Up Click have been so linked in the public mind with the popularity of syrup.
Because it's the truth. You know what I'm saying? You know, the truth never hurt no one. You know what I'm saying? Big Mo, that's my partner. That was my dog. He used to almost sip too much. You know what I'm saying? There's a thing where, you know, no drug is good for you, whether you're doing a little or a lot. But sometimes you can abuse a drug. You know what I'm saying? And, for example, like the bottle, the same bottle, you know, most people, like he would say, you'll see a group of people sipping the bottle. You know, a lot of times, Mo wasn't going to give you none of his bottle. You know what I'm saying? He was going, and by the fact that it gives you the munchies. It makes you hungry. You know what I'm saying? You be sluggish, a little lazy. And he was already overweight. Doctors he had just got a big exercise bike. You know, Big Mo was 600 pounds when he died. You know, the doctor had told him, you have to exercise. You know what I'm saying? But you're not going to want to exercise if you're sipping all the time. You know what I'm saying? So it's just the truth. We are stuck with the stuck with that stereotype because of that's what we was really around. DJ Screw was a real sipper. You know what I'm saying? He kept him some cruise or somewhere, kept him something to drink. So there's no way we can deny it. You know, we can't sit here and say, yeah, he didn't sip.
Never happened.
He sipped. So just that our clique, screwed up clique, you know, which we wasn't selling syrup, but just because we was rapping about it and it was just so big around us, there's no way we'll be able to erase this title that is on top of us. You know what I'm saying? It's just going to be here on out. And as long as people are still sipping, it's still going to always attribute back to screwed up clique, DJ Screw, Big Mo, just because they used to sip too.
And I hope that events like this will let people see, you know, the broader picture too.
Yes, talent.
You want to close us out with a thought, Randy?
I mean, I just want to close out with saying I feel like the whole basis of the syrup epidemic came from screw tapes, and I feel like the whole culture of Houston came from screw tapes. I mean, because I feel like the screw tapes had got so big at one time to where we didn't realize, because like I think Kiki was saying in the earlier panel, is that we were stuck in these five little hoods that we didn't hear the outside, but the outside was listening to us loud and clear, you know, and it got to the point to where it almost took screw dying for us to wake up and listen to the rest of the world. Because while he was alive, we was only paying attention to screw. We was only paying attention to your music if it was on the screw tape, and we was only paying attention to what people were saying on screw tapes. You know what I'm saying? So I just feel like people need to really understand how big the DJ Screw was to Houston and the world and his music, and appreciate him for his talent. I mean, that's all I can really say. That's where I want to close out. He was the greatest DJ ever, really. You know, he went to New York at a time when DJ K Slay, all these Funkmaster Flex, all these DJs was the hottest DJs in the country at the time, and he went there and got DJ of the Year against these people. So I gotta commend him myself.
And I just want to say in closing, I think one of the things that's so interesting about the screw tapes and why people have so much love for them and why I think it's important for the library to collect them is because they do capture that feel of a group of people talking to each other, talking about what they're doing, and not kind of looking to the outside world, but talk about their own culture.
Right.
And I want to thank Dr. Peters, ESG, and Lil Randy for all being exceptionally good sports to come talk about syrup.